Hallelujah. Lord, there's a spirit in this place right now. There's a sweet spirit in this place. If you can hear my voice, and there's something, maybe you didn't come to the altar to cast your care. There's something you're sitting there that's really heavy on you, so heavy that you couldn't move. I want you to know that Jesus will come to your seat. He'll come right where you're at right now. And when he gets there, if you just believe him to take that heavy burden, he'll do it right where you are seated at right now. No matter what the pain is, no matter what level the pain is, if you say, Lord, take this heaviness away right now, he'll do it. Take this pain, this discomfort. He'll do it right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Some of you saw our friend, Pastor Eugene McBride, situation he's going through right now. Boy, I tell you that it's been heavy in my spirit. His family, what he's facing. And I want to pray for him right now. He will always be my friend. Amen. 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 Praise God. Amen. Father, we give you honor. We give you praise in the name of Jesus. We pray, God, for Eugene and his family, God. God, we just pray that your hand would be upon him and his family right now. And God, that you would do as you have already done since this thing happened, that you would continue to lead him down the path of restoration. God, that you would bless his friends and his family to undergird him at this moment with love. Hallelujah. Not the love that denominations have, not the love that we as individuals have, but the love that is spoken of in your word. And that we would be the church of the word of God, and not the church of a denomination. So God, being the church of the word of God, you instruct us that when someone falls, to restore them. Hallelujah. So that we ourselves won't fall. And so God, because of your word, and because we follow the word that you have spoken to us, we lift our brother up. And we give you praise, we give you honor, and we give you glory for his life. And Father, everything that can be turned around, turn it around in the name of Jesus. And everything that has to be dealt with, Lord, walk with him as it's being dealt with. Walk with his wife, walk with his children, walk with his friends and his family. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. Yes. Hallelujah. Praise God for our children and our children's church. Amen. Our children's pastor there. Even as they go and prepare. Amen. For their Christmas production. Amen. Look at that new church. That's the new church being right there. Amen. We were once the new church, but that's the church right there. Deacons and missionaries, evangelists, and pastors and preachers, and teachers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. And no telling where those no feet are going to go, amen, to carry the gospel of Jesus Christ. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Mike, can you sing a little bit of that?
It's all right now.
Yeah.
It's all right now.
Yes.
Be encouraged. God said.
God said.
It's all right now.
Hallelujah. Yeah.
It's all right now.
It's all right.
It's all right now.
God said.
God said it's all right now.
Hallelujah.
It's all right now.
It's all right. It's all right.
It's all right now.
God said.
God said.
He said it's all right.
It's all right now.
Not tomorrow, but right now.
It's all right now. It's all right now.
Hallelujah.
God says it's all right now.
Hallelujah. Well, we've been teaching on our personal relationship with God. Amen. And the importance of that relationship and how we are to establish that relationship. And praise God. Amen. The word on last Sunday, amen, how it continued to direct us down that path, the path of our faith in God, and the path that we are to have in our personal relationship with God. Amen. Every believer has to have a personal relationship with God, not a personal relationship with their pastor. I want a personal relationship with you, but that don't get you anywhere, amen. Won't get you a cup of coffee or anything, amen. But God wants us to have a personal relationship with Him.
Amen.
And that relationship is not based on a denomination. Amen. It's not based on any protocols or procedures, amen. Matter of fact, I'm against those things, amen. Because sometimes we find ourselves following the procedures and the protocols of a denomination and not the Word of God. And people find their God in their denomination. But we don't talk about the God of the denomination in here, amen. Because the God of the denomination will cause you to do things to people that's ungodly. We only talk about the God of the Bible. Amen. The God of the Bible and the God of the denomination sometimes are completely different. Amen. Amen. What God says and what God will do is sometimes different than what we as believers will do based on our direction in a denomination. So I'm encouraging you to know the God of the Bible and not the God of any denomination. Amen. Because sometimes they're slightly different, amen. And that difference can cause you to miss it. But when you know the God of the Bible, you're able to stand in every storm, amen. You're able to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. You should be able to treat people as God treat us, amen. And sometimes denominations are happy treating people opposite of what God will, how God will treat us, amen. Praise God. But we are a church where we believe God. And because we believe God, the Bible says to be ye holy. Amen. God tells us to be holy. Amen. I'm talking to believers this morning. Amen. God says be what? Be holy. Amen. Be holy. If God tells us to be holy, that means we can what? Be holy. God wouldn't tell us something that we couldn't do. If God say be holy, that means we can be holy. Amen. Amen. We can be holy. So we've been teaching and talking on our personal relationship with God. That we must have a personal, you must have a personal relationship with God. And we've given you some tools
some things that that will help you develop that relationship with God. One, we talked that a believer and a person who's establishing a relationship has to do what every day? Has to pray every day. And if you're praying every day, then you ought to read your Bible every day. You ought to read the Word of God every day. The Bible says that heaven and earth shall pass away, but the Word of God is going to endure for what? Forever. So we read the Word of God every day. And then we also meditate. So we pray, we read the Word of God, and we meditate. There's no specific order. We pray, we read the Word of God, we meditate. We also find ourselves, because of life challenges and life storms, we find ourselves having to fast sometimes. Amen. So sometimes you are going through something that's going to require you to fast and pray. Amen. That means you're going to have to push away from something, push away from the table, turn your plate over, turn off social media so that you can spend more time with God. Amen. Fasting is our decision. Amen. Fasting is your decision to get things aligned in your life so that your focus is on God. Amen. And the intent and it's on purpose so that we can what? Build our relationship with God. We need a personal, you need a personal relationship with God. Amen. Not a personal relationship with your church. Not a personal relationship with the pastor or just being excited about serving in an auxiliary. Praise God for all those things. But if you're doing those things without really knowing God, without having a personal relationship with God, then he probably don't know you. Amen. A lot of folk going to church today, God don't know them. Amen. Now I can tell you about LeBron James and I can tell you his stats. I can't tell you that, but I can read them and then I can repeat them and I can say, oh, I know LeBron James. I know all about LeBron James, but I can see LeBron James climbing off a plane and say, hey, LeBron. He said, I don't know you.
Amen.
I know everything about him, but he don't know everything about me because I don't have a personal relationship with him.
Amen.
And you can come to church and serve in church and say, I go to church. I was baptized when I was little. You ask folk, you're a Christian? Say, yeah, I was baptized when I was young. Now I ain't asked you that. I've been going to church since No, do you have a relationship with God? The relationship you have with your spouse, the relationship you have with your children, is that the same relationship you have with God? The way you communicate with your spouse or with your children or with your best friend, is that the relationship you have with God? Do you spend time with him? Do you long to call him to tell him something? When something good happens to me or something good happens or I get good news, I can't wait to call Henrietta and say, hey, baby, let me tell you what's going on. Let me tell you what just happened. Because I want to tell her, and that's because we have a relationship. Amen. And so do you have that kind of relationship with God? You develop that relationship through prayer. And through reading the Word of God. Through meditating on the Word of God. And through fasting and praying. And also through what you just experienced. The assembly, fellowshipping. When you come to this place, we did what? We lift our hands, we praised God, we sung songs, amen, about God. We lifted God up. We gave, as a corporate body of believers, we gave ourselves an opportunity to pray with one another, amen. And so all of these things are designed to build our personal relationship with God. Amen. Because we need that relationship. We must have that relationship. Amen. We talked on this Wednesday that God is our shepherd and that we shall not want. Amen. And that he make us to do what? Lie down in green pastures. He do what else? He restored our soul. Amen. He brings restoration to our soul. Some of you are healed today because you've been sick. You've been sick and you're healed because he's a restorer. Amen. And because you went to him because you knew that he was your shepherd.
Yes.
Amen. And a shepherd does three things. He feeds the sheep. He shields the sheep and he guides the sheep. And so because you know that God is your shepherd, when you went through something, you knew you could call him and that he would feed you his word, that he would shield you from the disease, and he would guide you to maintain healing through your prayer, through your fasting, through believing him. So he's our shepherd. Say he's my shepherd.
He's my shepherd.
Come on, say it like he don't belong to nobody else but you. He's my shepherd. Amen. Some kids, they don't say our daddy, they say my daddy. And it could be four or five of them in the house. Lauren always said, my dad. Like, I ain't got no other kids, you know. It ain't our daddy. She can talk to her sibling and say, my daddy. Like he really got three other husbands. Amen. But amen. But that's how God wants us to think about him.
Yeah.
He's mine. Say, he's mine.
He's mine.
Amen. So, the Lord is my shepherd. It didn't say the Lord is our shepherd.
Amen.
Make it personal. Amen. I make it personal.
Amen.
The Lord is my shepherd.
Amen.
Say mine.
Mine.
I shall not walk.
I shall
okay,
not.
So he restored your soul. What else do he do? He leads you in the path of what?
Righteousness.
For his name's sake.
Amen.
Not for your name. He leads you in a righteous path. Amen. He leads you in a way that is right with him.
Amen.
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 What else do he do? He restored your soul. Is that where he restored it?
Yeah.
He leads you in the path of righteousness, restored your soul. What else you do? Through the valley of the shadow of death, you will do what?
Fear
anybody
no
fear the evil in here?
No.
How you gonna fear evil with God walking with you?
Amen.
God walking with you, there is no evil.
No.
Where the presence of God is, evil is no longer present.
Yeah.
Evil is only present where God's not. Amen. Einstein, as a little boy, he figured that out when his teacher said, does evil exist? And the class said, yeah, evil exists. He said, well, did God create everything? And the teacher said, did God create everything? And the kid said, yeah, God created everything. He said, well, if God created everything, then God is evil. And they said, no, God's not evil. He said, did God create everything? Yeah, God created everything. Well, if God created everything, then God is evil. Then look, boy raised his hand and said, teacher, he said, does coal exist? And the teacher said, yeah, coal exists. He said, I tell you, coal does not exist. Coal only exists where there's an absence of heat. If you heat the room up, coal no longer exists. Right? He says, teacher, does light exist? And the teacher said, yeah, light exists. Oh no, does darkness exist? See, yeah, darkness exists. He said, teacher, darkness does not exist. Darkness, where is darkness at right now? Darkness only exists where there's an absence
Amen.
Of light. Where did the darkness go when these lights come on? It had to go. Couldn't comprehend the dark. Couldn't comprehend the light. So he went back and said, teacher, I'm telling you, evil does not exist. Evil is only present where there's an absence of God. When a man go and blow somebody, hit, shoot somebody, why did that happen? Why did that evil exist in his heart? Because there was no presence of God. Wherever God exists, there's no evil. Y'all follow me? So although God is walking, you walking through a valley of evil, the Lord is with you. You understand? When God starts walking, evil has to go.
Amen.
When you bring God into your heart, evil has to go. Y'all understand that? You understand that? Because when you walk in a room and it's dark, you turn the lights on and the darkness has to what? You be hoping that electric bill can pay. Amen. Because if not, that darkness is going to do what? Scream. But when you flip them switch, oh, thank God that light came in and took away that darkness. And when that darkness went, fear went with it. Huh?
Amen.
Praise God. So when so the Lord is saying, the Lord is my shepherd. Okay, so the Lord is my shepherd. So now we understand, we got to pray, we got to meditate, we got to fast, we got to read the word of God, we got to not forsake the assembling of ourselves. We know the Lord is our shepherd, that he feeds us, he shields us, he guides us. So now we got to understand the position that God wants us in. Okay? So he wants us to be holy. God said, be ye holy. Say, be ye holy. Child of God, you can't be holy if you're carrying around a whole bunch of stuff in your heart.
Amen.
A whole bunch of sin that you're holding on to. No matter how large, no matter how small it is, if you've got that stuff in your heart, you cannot be holy like God wants you to be holy. And where you're not holy, when you're not holy, then the Holy Spirit cannot work in you. Hallelujah. We're not alone. I can't figure this thing out on my own. But I have the Holy Spirit. Amen. Acts 1 and 8. Acts 1 verse 8. Praise God. It says, but ye shall receive, say, power.
Power.
Come on, say it like it's power.
Power.
Amen. Amen. You shall receive what?
Power.
And so, because you're establishing your relationship with God, you're establishing that personal relationship with God, you continue to grow. You continue to receive from God. He continues to feed you. And when God is feeding you, you're receiving the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit become available to you to receive the Holy Ghost. Amen. How many of you got the Holy Ghost in here? Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Everybody's head ought to go up because you either have it or you want it. You either have it or you're seeking it. Amen. Praise God. How many of you say, I'm seeking the Holy Ghost? Look no further. Praise God. If you believe, receive. Amen. You believe, receive. Just like you're breathing right now, you don't see the air, the oxygen in the air, yet you don't question that. You don't say, well, I'm going to stop this breathing thing because I don't really know if there's 21% oxygen in this air. No, you just keep on breathing. And if it got stuff in here, you'll go outside and breathe. Because you believe that there's oxygen in this air, in this atmosphere, and you're breathing it, right? And so that's the way you got to believe the Holy Spirit. That because you believe God, and because he said, I will not leave you comfortless, but I'm going to go to the Father, and he's going to send you another comforter, that you got to believe there is a Holy Spirit, amen. And that Holy Spirit, amen, woo, Jesus. You think you smart? Believers ain't smart. It's the Holy Ghost in us that's smart. Say Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost.
God, he's a person. He's a person. God was here. He created everything. He spoke and there was. And then he tagged off and Jesus came. Jesus came down and did all that he was going to do and all that he needed to do to redeem us back and to bring us back. And he tagged off in the Holy Ghost. Y'all can relate to that because most of us used to watch them wrestling matches, amen. When them guys would stand on the rope and they'd get beat down and they reach over there and tag in and the other one jump in. But the Holy Ghost don't jump in. And he is for us. Amen. The Father, Son, and Holy Ghost are one. But they have three different roles. And the role of the Holy Ghost now is to bring everything to your remembrance. To be your counselor. To be your guide. To be your standby. To be your helpmeet. Amen. Everything you need. Amen. I ain't so smart. People just think I am. It's the Holy Ghost on the inside of me. Amen. Praise God. It says, and ye shall receive, say, power.
Power.
Dynamite. Dunamis power.
Yeah. Yeah.
Woo. Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be, say, a witness.
Amen.
Unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Amen. The Holy Ghost, amen, on the inside of us, make us a witness. Amen. So my relationship with God, amen, because I pray, because I meditate, because I read the Word of God, because I believe the God of the Bible.
Amen.
I keep saying that for a reason. Some denominations don't believe in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
They don't believe in healing. They don't believe in those things. They think that those things were during biblical times, which is an indication that they follow their denomination and they don't follow the Bible. Because all through the 28 chapters of the book of Acts, there are acts of the Holy Ghost. It's a book that hasn't been finished yet. It doesn't end. The 28th chapter does not end like the other books of the Bible end. And the reason being is because the acts of the Holy Ghost have not stopped yet.
Amen. Amen.
Anybody got healed? Amen. That's an act of the Holy Ghost. Anybody got delivered? That's an act of the Holy Ghost. It'll never end. Because the Holy Ghost is still doing the work. Power.
Amen.
Dunamis power. Amen. When you believe God, the Holy Ghost begins to work on the inside of you when you believe the Holy Ghost. Amen?
Amen.
The Holy Ghost. Say the Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost.
In Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and in the uttermost parts, being our houses, our places of employment.
Yeah.
That spirit that's on the inside of you will change and transform your house.
Amen.
Change and transform your job.
Amen.
Change and transform everything you put your hands on. Amen?
Amen.
Come on, touch somebody. Touch somebody. Touch somebody. Say, I'm touching you with the dunamis power.
Amen.
Touch them again. Amen.
Amen.
I'm touching you with dunamis power. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So be healed in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
You ain't got no power of your own. You got dunamis power. You got Holy Ghost power. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. In 1 Peter 1:13, it says, wherefore gird up the loins of your mind and be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Revelation revealed. As Jesus Christ is revealed to you, there's grace that's going to, that you're going to have knowledge of. And the grace of God, listen to me, it causes us as believers to be sober. To be sober. Amen. So in my relationship with God, I am not going to allow things to intoxicate me. I'm not going to allow what I see to be an emergency. It's on fire every time. It ain't going to happen. Because the grace, because I understand who Jesus is. He has been revealed to me. And the revelation comes from the Holy Ghost. Who opens up my ability to reveal, to understand things that are not understood by my natural mind.
Amen.
You don't, as a believer, you don't see things with your natural mind. What other people see, you don't see. Because God always shows us the end before he shows us the beginning. So the end shows me what it's going to be like. I don't understand. I don't see the beginning. Because the beginning, if God showed us the beginning, it would discourage us.
Amen.
Example, if God had showed Moses, he told Moses, go tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Moses had no idea all the plagues that was going to have to come. Moses had no idea that the people were going to be hard-headed and stiff-necked and rebel against him. He had no idea all that was going to happen. Had God told him that, Moses would have probably said, no, I'm going to stay here and tend to Jethro's sheep. Joseph only saw folk bowing down to him. He didn't see the pit. He didn't see the dungeon. He didn't see being accused of rape. All he saw was when he told his brothers, I had a dream last night. Y'all were going to be bowing down to me. The stars and the moons were going to be bowing down to me. And his brothers said, oh, yeah? And they threw him in the pit. And I bet Joseph in that pit said, now, God, you ain't show me this. Had you showed me this, I'd have kept my mouth closed. So God always shows us, say, the end before the beginning. That's good news. That's good news. The good news is that the Holy Ghost reveals things to us. And so if God showed you the end, doesn't matter what the journey is, you're going to get there. Amen. Say, I'm going to get there. Amen. God showed you that you were going to be healed, but he didn't show you you were going to need chemo. He didn't show you all the weight you were going to lose, and the pain, and the hair, and the throwing up. He didn't show you all of that. All he showed you was that by his stripes, you were healed. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
So the Holy Ghost, say the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost helps us from being intoxicated when we're going through. Because Jesus has been revealed to us. So when the Bible says be sober, it's the opposite of being intoxicated. Being sober means I can think. Being sober means my head's all right. Amen. So it says, as obedient children, not fashion yourselves according to the former lust in your ignorance. There was a time when we were ignorant. We were ignorant. And listen, don't be ignorant today. Don't ignore the word of God and allow sin, say sin, to live in your heart. Your sin will find you out. It'll find you out. Your sin will expose you. Your sin, the devil is constantly trying to get you in the right position where he can flip the light on. So that everybody will know that you are not what you say you are. So don't be ignorant. Don't be ignorant. Don't be ignorant according to grace. That because the grace of God abounds, I can continue to sin.
Amen.
Because of God's grace abounds. Even Paul had to clarify that in the book of Romans. They said, wait a minute, this gospel thing sounds all right. That means we can continue to sin. You know, because God gonna forgive us. Didn't say anything about the consequences, did he? Amen. And gets AIDS, amen. Will God, the grace of God, forgive him? You better believe it. Does that HIV have a chance of killing him? You better believe it. The consequences of it. You go and rob a store. You don't kill nobody, but you rob a store. With at gunpoint, and you get caught, will God forgive you? If you repent, you better believe it. But Steve Prater gonna have you up there in the jailhouse, and Steve Prater is not gonna forgive you. And Judge Stewart is not gonna forgive you. Amen. They hand you a Bible so you can be, you know, well knowledge in 10 or 20 years when you get out. Amen. Amen. Don't be ignorant. Amen. Don't be ignorant in your sin. Amen. Sin will find you out. Amen. Your sin will find you out.
Amen.
So you have to, listen, the lust, go back to that for me, sister. The lust that's in your heart, listen, you have to, say former lust. It says, as obedient children, not fashion yourselves according to the former lust in your ignorance. There was lust that was in our ignorance. There was stuff that made you sick, sin that made you sick. And you got saved, and you said, I'm not doing this anymore. I'm not living this way anymore. You threw it up. It made you sick. You can't eat it any longer. I can't eat lust. I can't eat anger. I can't eat being a whoremonger. I can't eat being an adulteress. I can't eat being a fornicator. I can't eat being a liar. And you did what? You threw it up. Because now that you're saved, that stuff makes you sick. But when you're ignorant and you form a lust, you'll be like the Bible say, a dog who returns to his vomit. Why did that dog go back and eat his own vomit? Because it was connected to his DNA. What's something in that? It's because he connected to it. And so if we don't sever the sin that's on the inside of us by giving it to God, because I don't know about you, maybe you superwoman, superman, I wasn't strong enough to get rid of everything on my own. I wasn't. Some of that stuff I had to say, Lord, get this out of me. This thing done got roots and all kind of stuff going every kind of way. Amen. And I can't uproot it on my own. I cut a little branch off, but that thing eventually start back growing. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And I need the Lord to lay the axe at the root of it and cut this thing up out of me. And I'm not ignorant to believe that I can do it on my own. And don't you be ignorant either. The Holy Ghost tell me you can't do it. Amen. Don't be ignorant of grace. Don't be ignorant of mercy. Don't be ignorant of it. I can go live any kind of way, do anything I want to. No, you can't. What child of God wants to in the first place? What child of God who has the revelation from the Holy Spirit who want to keep on living unrighteous and not be holy if you say, amen? Salvation means something. Come here, Brother Adrian. Salvation means something. Amen. It means that me and Adrian, we used to hang out. Let's say if we used to hang out, amen, and we used to be friends, and all of a sudden I received God and I received Jesus. Now I'm set apart. A holy life means set apart. I don't do the things I used to do. The former lust. Amen. If I do, I'm ignorant. If I do, I'm ignorant. Amen. Thank you, brother. As obedient children, not fashion yourself according to the former lust and your ignorance. Amen. Say, I'm not ignorant any longer.
I'm not ignorant any longer. Mm-hmm.
But as he which has called you is holy. The God that called you, you have been called. Everyone in here, everybody in here who has received Jesus Christ, you've been called. I don't care if your grandma took you to church or Aunt Susie or whoever took you to church. If you saved today, you saved because you were called. God called you, and you heard him in your spirit, and you said in your spirit that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's a call. It says, and when I call you, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Now, I'm going to give you a second to think about the conversation. Are you talking? Are you speaking in every way? And this conversation is not just talking about talking. Not just talking about speaking from your mouth. Conversation is you, where you go, what you do. It's your life. It's how you live. And our man, conversation is not just what comes from my mouth. Because I can sit up and say, praise the Lord, glory to his name. Hallelujah. Isn't he wonderful? Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. And walk right out there and give me a drink. Walk right out there and smoke me a joint. Walk right out there and live unholy. I can say all those things to you and have all kind of evil in my heart. Church, it sounds funny, but it ain't godly. It ain't holy. He says, be holy, so be holy in all matters. Anybody not convicted? If your lifestyle don't convict you, if where you go, how you live, how you talk, what you do, who you have conversation with, if that don't convict you, you ought to fall down on your own knees. You ought to be like, I can't wait to get to church. I'm gonna stop right here on the corner of Roberts and Hollywood and get on my knees. If you are not convicted by your conversation, by the manner of your lifestyle, if you're not convicted, if you're not brought to conviction, ooh, that's scary. That is really scary, church. If you are comfortable living unholy and unrighteous and knowing that there is a God who stands in heaven looking over the balcony of heaven at your life, and you're okay living that way in front of him just because you're out of sight of the church, something wrong with you. And you haven't been really, the revelation of the Holy Ghost hadn't revealed that God is all knowing to you. And that God sees you, and somewhere, some church has confused you with the grace and with the mercy of God. We serve a loving and a merciful God. We serve a God who is a God of grace. But he can't be mocked. You can't mock him. You can't use him, because you're just the law of sin will find you out. And we don't worry about that as believers, because we're holy. You understand? We're holy. We don't worry about, I don't live right because I'm worried about how you see me. I live right because of God. Because of my love for God. The love of God constrains me. Keeps me. So if you're not convicted of your walk, then you gotta come up here after the altar call. You gotta say, Lord, you gotta check yourself. Amen. Because it is written, be ye holy, say, for I am holy. God said it's written, be ye holy. God would not tell us something to do that we couldn't do. He ain't gonna say be holy if you can't do it. You can do it because of the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is your helper. I can't do it on my own. Amen. You can't even treat people right on your own. How are you going to love people, love your neighbors as you love yourself? How are you going to do that without the Holy Ghost? Somebody did you wrong and treat you wrong, and your next door neighbor don't even speak to you, or take your parking space, and people on your job, amen, lie on you. How are you going to love them as you love yourself without the Holy Ghost? You can't do it. You have to have the Holy Ghost. That will help you love people even when they do you wrong. And this is all a part of me building my relationship with God. Because as long as I'm walking with God, come here, God, just step down. As long as I'm walking with God, I'm all right. I'm walking with God, I'm all right. Amen. Let me get y'all up here like I did on Wednesday night. Amen. Because I got all this distraction. Come here, distract my distractors. I know you were here Wednesday night, but you're still a pretty good distractor. So when you have all these issues of life that you're going to face, amen, stay right here for a second, God, and you think every day, tomorrow, you got some stuff you're going to face. Amen. You have some stuff you know about, some stuff you don't know about. But guess what? That stuff is already in Monday, lining itself out. Said, come on, we got a few hours to go before she get here. But that stuff is already waiting for you, and it's already waiting to discourage you, to break you down, to tear you down, to do all these things. But God said, be holy for I'm holy. So if I'm mindful of that, let me show you what happens when you walk through. You walk through and you got all this noise going on. All this chattering going on. Y'all make a little noise for me. All this distraction. And you over here, because you hadn't prayed, you hadn't meditated, you hadn't read your word. Amen. You hadn't allowed the Holy Ghost to work. Look how far you went from God. So the Bible said God is always speaking to you. But you can't hear him over the noise. You can't hear him over the stuff that's going on in your life. Amen. And so what happens is you're going to make a bad decision right here. And you're going to get discouraged right here. And you might give up right here. Yes. Amen. But when you walk in with God, look what happened. Y'all keep making noise. You still got the noise going on. You still got the distractions going on. But you walk in with God. Because you prayed, because you meditated, because you read the word of God, because you didn't forsake the sin of yourself, you fasted and you still got this going on. You still got a bad report from the doctor. Your children still ain't doing what they're supposed to do. Our children still ain't doing what they're supposed to do. Amen. Your job is still got in trouble, but you're with God.
Amen.
And so, because you're walking through it with God, then God is doing what? He's directing you. He's leading you. And look how close he is. You can hear him.
Amen.
Amen. And when listen, thank you. All this is going to happen. All this is going to happen every day. This, because Jesus said we live in a world where there's tribulation and there's trouble. He says, but be of good cheer. I've overcome. So listen. So in me being holy, I want to do everything that God has instructed me to do. So that as I walk through life, he said, don't worry about tomorrow. God said, come here, God. God said, don't worry about tomorrow. Said tomorrow, take care of itself. You know why? Because God already in tomorrow.
Amen.
He's already in tomorrow. And he ain't dealing with this. He's just there so that when you get there, because he's here and he there. Because he God. He can be everywhere at the same time. Amen. So when I get into tomorrow, Monday, he right there to care of me. You follow what I'm saying? And listen, that happens. Because I'm holy. Amen. That happens because I haven't been ignorant to the stuff that's in my heart. To the formulas. The stuff that's still trying to hold on. The stuff that's still trying to grab me and direct me. Stuff that I'm still trying to, you know, you're still trying to please people. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. You're still trying to please people. You're still trying to be something that you're not. Still living a lie. When God is living the way God wants you to live, is easy. It's easy. He said, my yoke is what? Easy, man. It ain't strangling you. It's not choking you. He said, it's easy. Amen. And if ye call on the Father, who, without respect of person, judge it according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. Go to the next one for me. For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as the Lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world, but was manifest in these last times for who?
You.
Amen. So say for me.
Me.
Thanks, Miss Burley. For me. Miss Burley knows her Bible don't say me, but she said for me. Right. Amen. Because listen, you have got to see this thing for me.
Right.
I can't see this thing for Adrian, amen.
Amen.
All Pastor Corey, I got to see it for me.
Amen.
This thing got to work for me.
Amen.
Amen. Who by him do believe in God, that raised him from the dead, and gave him glory, that you, say your faith, and hope might be in
God.
So listen, so me being holy, me pursuing a relationship, a personal relationship with God, me pursuing that relationship with God is going to cause me to pray. It's going to cause me to meditate. It's going to cause me to read my word. It's going to cause me to assemble. It's going to cause me to fast when I need to fast. Me doing that is going to always identify God as my shepherd. And it's going to always want me to have God right next to me. I want God to be with me. He's my shepherd. And I want him to walk me through every situation. And I want, listen, and my daily, say my daily, desire is to be holy. To be holy, and because he's holy, and to have a heart that is cleansed of sin. Not play with sin, not toy with sin, and not hang around people who do. Amen. I'm a preacher, y'all. Listen to me. I'm a preacher, but I'm too weak to be around people that live unholy life. I read my Bible probably as much as everybody in it. I'm probably in the top five. Amen. I pray I'm probably in the top five. Amen. But I'm not strong enough. Y'all might be strong. I don't know how you do it. I'm not strong enough to walk every day in this world without God walking with me.
Amen.
Y'all can do it. Give me, I don't even want to know your secret. You keep your secret to yourself. But I cannot do it on my own. I can't. Because as soon as, whenever I get a little slack on reading the word or praying, man, I'm right back to that vomit. My thoughts are right back to where they used to be. Which let me know that it's only the presence of God, the Holy Spirit, the dunamis power that's keeping me. That's helping me. So listen to me. Tell somebody else that lie about you holy and righteous and thank you, Lord, and praise the Lord. If you ain't reading your Bible, that ain't nothing but a bunch of words coming from your mouth. The only way you can live holy and the only way you can live righteous is having a relationship where you identify God. Stand up there, God. I know I changed your role. The only way is having God be your supreme. God has to be the head of your life. Amen. Me and God ain't on the same level. Me and Jesus, I'm joint heirs with Jesus, but God, I'm not on God's level. I'm not on his level. Amen. And I need him. You need him. We need him. Every day, if you don't get anything from church today, from the assembly today, you got to have a relationship with God.
Amen.
Where when you are by yourself or every day, you say, I have to spend time with God.
Amen.
Pastor Monique and Pastor Gore stand up and say, I'm sure they say with one another, I got to spend time with Monique. And Monique says, I got to spend time with Corey. Now they got a son. And they got to do that. They got to say, sometimes when Ian is asleep, we got to spend time with each other. I got to call my wife. I got to talk to my husband. That's our relationship. That's how relationships work. If you want a marriage that don't work, then being a marriage with a husband and a wife don't talk. They don't communicate. He sleep in this room. She sleep in that room. That's an arrangement, and that is not of God. And that's not a relationship. Listen, I don't know what that is. Because marriages are not roommates. Amen. Praise God. And so, in order for their marriage to work, they have to talk. And desire to talk. I can't wait to talk to my wife. I can't wait to talk to God. I can't wait to can't wait to commune with God. I want to read something that God wrote. That's a relationship. And so you desire to say, listen, the kids are down, my husband's at work, or my wife's at work or whatever. I'm going to take this time with God. Thank you, God. I'm going to take this time with God. This is, ain't no other way. It's no other way. Instead of saying, oh, I got an emergency and now I'm going to run to God. Why you got to run to God? You walk in with him, he'll be right there when you get a phone call.
Amen.
When the doctor gave you sitting there talking to God. Yeah, God, this, that, and the other. And the doctor walk in and give you the report. Then you, hand me the report. It can be tied in love. The doctor, hand you the report, you hand it to God.
Amen.
You're the doctor's office. He gave you something, you just give it to God. But most times, God way in Dallas. And you're at the doctor's office, and the doctor gave you the report, oh, God. And you call everybody but God. And then you got to run to Dallas to get a report to God. Y'all take God to the doctor with you?
Yeah.
Amen. You ought to take him to the store. with you. Amen. You won't spend so much money with God. God will say, you know. God will be like, you don't need that. You won't. I'm telling you the truth. God going with you. God, you be like, man, you be like, look at all these groceries I got. And look at all this money I still got. Because God know how to work it out.
Amen.
Know how to work it out. Praise God. It's not just about people blessing you and doing this for you and doing that for you. God will do everything for you. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Come on, tell what I say. All right, my last verse, 1:23. Amen. 1:23. Oh, this is seeing ye have purified your soul in obedience, the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love, and brethren, see that ye love one another with a what? Pure heart, fervently, being born again, not of what? Corruptible seed. The seed that was in us, y'all, from Adam, was corrupted. Corrupted. We're not born of that seed. That's why we've been born again. Everybody been born again in here?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, act like it, act like it, act like it. Don't just say it, act like it. So when people see you, you don't have to be toting your Bible around and they say, oh, you must be a Christian. People ought to see you without your Bible. Without your dress hanging down here. Without your head in a bun. So tight when you blink, it moves. People ought to see you. Listen, people ought to see you holy. Y'all understand what I'm saying? They'll see you holy in your conversation. People ought not see you somewhere and say, I can't believe she there. I can't believe he there. I can't believe she's talking like that. I can't believe you're talking like that. I can't believe I saw such and such and they was doing this or they were doing that. Yeah. I'm holy. I ain't trying to put on no front. I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about you say, I'm not trying. This is who I am. I'm born again. I'm not born of a corrupted seed. I'm born of an incorrupted seed. Amen. And listen, I have the victory because of my relationship with God. Amen. Every day. Henrietta would not like it if I talked to her once a week. Now you think about the person that you have a relationship with or friendship with or children or whatever. If you talk to them every day, now what happens now if all of a sudden you only spoke with them one time a week? Why would that be? Like, is something wrong with us? Everything okay with us? If you talk to them every day and everybody's like, we good? We still good? Wait, what you think God say? He looking over the back of their head and saying, hey, we good?
Amen.
We good, because you ain't called on me in a long time. You don't talk to me on a regular basis. You just call me when you need me. You just call me when you get in a bind. But that's not the relationship God wants to have with you. God wants to have a relationship with you that every day his child come to him. 5 minutes. Who can't give God 5 minutes a day? 5 minutes. Praise God. And God is so, listen, you can't text God. You can't text him. You know, we got so accustomed, you can't text God, your phone. Because God ain't got no phone number. You can't text him. He ain't got no cell phone. You can't say, I'm going to text God. You got to talk to him.
Amen.
It's your mouth. You got to talk to him. Amen. Amen. By the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Amen. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. Come on, stand up. Amen. Church is a little long, but praise God, it was long and good.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Nobody gets mad at sitting at a restaurant where the food is good. And keep bringing out good food, you just keep eating that good food, amen. And most of us don't get up and leave until dessert. Amen. You don't know, man, they bring out too much food, man. I'll see y'all later. No. You're going to sit there and keep eating and eating and eating. And then you're going to say, hey, write me to go. I'll tell you.
Amen.
And praise God. Here, we want you to take food home.
Amen.
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 Here, we want you to walk out of here with a food container and take as much as you want.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Come on, lift your hands to the Lord. God, we desire in our hearts to be holy because you say be ye holy, for you are holy. And God, we know, dear God, without the Holy Ghost that we can't do anything. And Father, we're not ignorant in believing, dear God, that we can continue to live the way we once lived with the former lust in our heart and that that's pleasing to you. We know now that it's not pleasing to you. And Father, we don't desire to live that way, and we will not live that way. For God, you have instructed us to be holy, so we lift our hands and our hearts to you. Those who are here, Lord, who are burdened and heavy in their hearts, those who are still have the root of sins in their heart, who live that way without regret, who live that way even with regret, but continue to live that way. God, we pray, I pray, dear God, on their behalf, Lord, that God, that they will open their mouths and just ask you, Lord, take this away from me. Take it away, Lord. Take it away. God, I'm convicted today through the word of God. Your word has convicted me and brought me to a place where I desire to live holy, where I desire to be righteous, where I identify you as my shepherd, as the one that feeds me, shields me, and guides me. And I desire, dear God, to live this life for the rest of my life with you, God. So, Lord, I pray for my relationship with you, that today I will begin to pray and meditate, fast, and read your word, and continue to assemble, dear God, as much as I can with other believers. And I will believe the God of the Bible, the God that inspired the writings, and I will believe you, Lord. So, God, I thank you for never leaving me nor forsaking me. I thank you, Lord, for opening up my blind eyes and removing doubt and unbelief from my heart. I thank you, dear God, for blessing me to be in a place where your word will come down like manna from heaven. Dear God, so let me take it. Let me place it in my heart. And I seal my heart, dear God, that your word, which is a seed, will begin to grow. And that it will begin to produce fruit. And that those fruit will remain, dear God. And that my conversation, the manner of my conversation, and where I go and what I do and how I talk and how I live and how I conduct myself every day will be holy, will be righteous, will be pleasing to you, dear God, in every way, Lord. Oh, God, I pray from the bottom of my heart for this ministry, Lord, for every soul, dear God, that's here, for every person that can hear my voice, oh God, that your word, dear God, will transform our lives, oh God, and that we will not allow it to fall on hard or stony ground, dear God, but that the word today has fell in our hearts. In the name of Jesus, dear God, that nothing can rob it, nothing can take it, Lord. God, we water it with our thank yous. We water it with our praise. We water it, dear God, with our obedience unto you, dear God. Bless us, Lord. Bless us, God, as only you can. Heal us as only you can, God. Fix us as only you can, dear God. Holy Spirit, change us. Rearrange everything in us. Holy Spirit, come in and give us newness right now. Newness in every way. Oh, Holy Spirit, how we look to you right now to do those things that you are able to do and we are willing to allow you to do it. It's in Jesus' name we thank you and we praise you and we honor you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. If you're here today and you are without Christ Jesus, you're here today and you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You say, I'm here and I haven't received Jesus as my Lord and Savior, and I want to receive him today. I want to be saved today. I want to receive Jesus today. If you are here and you have not received Jesus, you listen, it is not a game, and it's not, you know, we're fortunate to be physically alive. But one day, you're going to be physically dead. And if you're not spiritually alive in Christ, you'll be eternally lost. You must be physically alive and spiritually alive because God has you have given your life to Christ. You have given your life to God. You are physically alive and spiritually alive. That when you physically die, you will have an eternal place with God. And you can only do that by accepting and confessing Jesus Christ as your Lord. Confessing with your mouth, believing in your heart that Jesus Christ, no one else, that Jesus Christ, and you got to believe it the right way. You can't believe, some folk believe Jesus is just a prophet, Jesus just this, Jesus is that. That ain't the same Jesus we're talking about here. And it is not the Jesus of this Bible. So you cannot be confused that Jesus was this, that, or the other. Jesus is the Son of God. He is the Redeemer of the world. He is the Lamb of God. He is the one who died on Calvary for sinners, for us, for you, for me. He took our sins and he died in our place. We're sinful. We are against God. But because you received Jesus, he became your substitute on that cross. And if you don't believe Jesus that way, you better check yourself because you got a whole different Jesus in mind. You got a whole different Jesus. You got to believe that he is the Son of God. He's the bright and morning star. You got to believe that he's the Redeemer of the world. He's the Lamb of God. And that he, you know, we celebrate his birth in this December. But we celebrate his death, which is more important than his birth. Because had he not died, then we wouldn't be redeemed. Had he not died, then we would have no place in heaven. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Amen. For Jesus' death, Jesus' burial, Jesus' resurrection, that has given us new life. If you're here today and you say, I don't know that Jesus, but I want to know him. I want to know the Jesus of the Bible. I invite you to come right now. I invite you to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. From this day forward, he will walk with you. He'll talk with you. He'll help you. He'll guide you. He'll lead you. Maybe you're here and you say, I know Jesus. I'm just looking for a place of worship where I can grow. A place where I can be accountable. A place where I can assemble. You can do that without joining. But when you join, it just makes you a part of. Not a part of the kingdom of God. You're already a part of that. But it makes you a part of this ministry where we can use you to serve. We can use you to do other things that will help others grow. So if you're here and you're saying, man, I just need a place where, and I believe this is where God is calling me to be a part of, we invite you to come now. Be a part of Abounding Grace. If you're here, I invite you to come. Praise God. Come on, give the Lord a hand of prayer. Let's receive our communion. In remembrance of Jesus Christ. In remembrance of him. A lot of people don't celebrate the birth of Christmas, the Christmas, because we as the church, as the body of believers, have joined them in such a big way in making it more commercial than Jesus. And we can put all kind of tags on it. We can make it sound real nice and this and that. But what I want you to do, I want you to remember, if we're going to celebrate the birth of Christ, and we are, you know, let's celebrate it. Amen. Let it be about Jesus. don't let it be about you. When you go to those stores and you start finding yourself stressed out about what you can and cannot buy, then it's not about Jesus anymore. It's not about Jesus. It's become about you. It's become about your children. Aren't we thankful? This generation of people, we are so thankful. Because we have been able to do more for our children than our parents were able to do for us. So almost every day, at least every week, if not every month, is a day of celebration for you being able to give your children something. Most of us got a pair of shoes when school started, a pair of shoes at Christmas. Now kids get shoes all through the week. And they got more shoes in their closet than we ever had. More toys than they'll ever play with. And let me tell you something. We have become the God that they look at. Our children don't see God. They see us. Instead of them saying, let me pray about this, they say, let me ask mom, let me ask dad. Man, how awesome would it be if we could teach our children to look to God? At this age, look to God. Let's make it about Jesus. Let's make it about Jesus. Because that's who it's about.
Amen.
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 His body was broken, that our bodies are healed. The Bible said ye were healed. By his stripes ye were healed. Today your body's healed because of the body of Jesus Christ that was broken. This is not a ritual, this is the truth. All of your sins, say all of my sins, under his blood. Say, I am
forgiven
because of the blood
of Jesus.
They ate and they drunk together. Your body's healed with that blood. With the body of Jesus. Thank you. Hallelujah.